grab your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Judges, chapter number 16. This is a familiar passage of Scripture. I'm going to use it as a basis of where we start, but we're looking at a few other things as well. You know that we've looked at the life of Samson in the past, Bible study and preaching before. I think probably when we look at judges, particularly at two of the judges, we love how that it has this magnificent end of victory. How God takes the underdog and he maximizes the resources particularly I'm thinking of Samson and Gideon in particular, God takes their resources and maximizes it and gives them the victory. Puts the enemy to flight. And I love that. And so I want to look, and we'll be referring to Gideon a little bit later, but I want to look at Samson and his life. More familiar with him, I'll reflect in a moment. But let's jump in and read verse number 25. And it came to pass when their hearts were merry, they're gathered together. Samson now is grinding the mill, chained up in brass. He is blinded. His eyes have been seared out. They called for Samson, all of these are full of stuff. They called for Samson that they might make sport of him. And they called for Samson out of the prison house and made them sport. And they set him between the pillars. And Samson said unto the lad who held him by the hand, suffer me that I may fill the pillars whereupon the house stands, that I may lean upon them. These weren't just decorative pillars. They were not just any pillars. But here we have two main pillars upon which the facility that all these folks were gathered in, partying, what was the holding pillars of this place. Samson said unto the lad, let's jump down to verse number 27. Now the house was full of men and women, and all the lords of the Philistines were there. And there were upon the roof about 3,000 men and women, probably the very elite of the Philistines, who beheld while Samson made sport. And Samson called unto the Lord and said, Oh, Lord God, amen. This means something a little deeper than what our eyes may reflect and look at. But he said, Oh, God of covenant. Oh, God of covenant. How many's entered into a covenant relationship with God? Amen, I have. Amen. So if you have a covenant relationship with God, you can call on Him in this covenant and He'll help you. Amen. Remember me, I pray you, and strengthen me, I pray thee. Only this once, O God, that I may be at once avenged of the Philistines for my two eyes. Samson took hold of the two middle pillars upon which the house stood, and on which it was borne up, one with his right hand and the other with his left. And Samson said, Let me die with the Philistines. And he bowed himself with all of his might, and the house fell upon the lords and upon all the people who were therein. So the dead which he slew in his death were more than they which he slew in his life. An amazing feat Samson did. Yes, I understand that some may look and say, this is the demise of Samson. But he died such a powerful death and slaying the enemies of the living God. This week, it was newsworthy that some Baptist missionaries in Iran went into eternity because they were killed at the hands of those that they were going to serve. What a powerful death when we die for God. Amen. What a powerful death when we die for God. And so we're looking at the life of Samson. Let me give you a little education of who he is. He's one of at least the 12 or 13 judges, however you want to look, some we're looking at more, of Israel. This was before the kings. You go on into, next will be 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel. You'll see the crowning of King Saul. You'll later see the crowning of King David. However, the spiritual condition of Israel was not good during the reigning of particularly several of these judges. They've allowed the gods of Baal to come in and really warp their way of thinking. So of these judges, Othniel and Ehud, Shamgar, a woman mixed in there, Deborah, Gideon, Tola, Jared, Jephthah, Ibzan, Elon, Abdon, and then Samson being these judges of Israel. Samson, his birth being very different than the birth of many others. Now, I know that for you, each one of us, our birth is unique and your children is unique to you. You remember it. However, the birth of Samson was different because there was an angelic proclamation of his birth, much like that of Isaac and much like that of John the Baptist and certainly of Jesus Christ. But there was this angelic message that is given in the birth of Samson. As he was born to Manoah, his father, this baby, Samson, became a Nazarite. The vows of the Nazarite was that there was never to be a razor that would touch his head. And he was never to drink strong drink that would affect his mind in any way. That was the vow that was given to him. And he's going to have a powerful impact upon the nation of Israel. God had called him for his life to have an impact. Let me say, our life is no different. God has called us for us and our life to have an impact upon those that we are around. I look at Gideon, he's like this fire that comes on the scene as a judge, and then he dims out as quick as he comes on. He's mentioned in a few verses, and then he's mentioned again in the book of Hebrews, chapter number 11. But the most important thing is for our life to have an impact, whether it's greatly well known among people or whether it isn't. God help our life to have an impact for the glory of God. That's why you're here this morning. You want your life to have an impact for the kingdom of God. And so, by the vows of the Nazarite, not a razor touching his head, his accomplishments, there are many. His hands alone, he's able to slay a lion. And if you feel like taking on a lion this morning, I'd rather leave that up to someone else. At least if all I'm left with is my hands. We know that he finds honey in the beast. He takes 300 fox and he attaches firebrands to their tail and he destroys the fields and the vineyards of the Philistines. I mean, he's just a mighty man. He takes the gates of the city upon his back and he removes them and carries them away. He fights the Philistines and a thousand of them, and then he finds water in the jawbone of the donkey. I mean, this man is amazing. The story of his life. But we find that even in his great victories, he has some big struggles that he faces. And there is some deficiency in his life. Let's be honest. If we look at our lives, you know very well what your deficiencies are. And yes, we all have them. But even in the middle of his deficiencies, he did great things for the kingdom of God. Even in your and my deficiencies, God is able to take them and do great things in our life if we will allow our lives to be led by the doctrines of God. And so Samson, the unfortunate part of his life, Daniel, is he finds this pretty young Philistine woman named Delilah, and Brother Walt, he begins to allow himself to become very lax with her. And she wants to know, where does his strength come from? Amen. The truth of the matter is, his strength came from God. In his own power, he was very weak. And so it wasn't just the giving of the length of his hair to Delilah eventually that led him to his weakness, but it was the compromise of his trusting in God and living by the doctrines of God. Listen, us and ourselves, we are very, very weak. Amen. And when we lay aside the Word of God, and when we lay aside a place of prayer, we lay aside the doctrines of God, we become weak in ourselves. Amen. Because we live in a world that will pull and pull and pull at us. Amen. And our own strength will never, ever be enough. We need the strength of God. Listen, the devil will lie to you and he'll tell you that he is very powerful. But I need to tell you this morning that the devil is not powerful. Long before this earth was even formed, amen, there was a falling out in heaven because Satan wanted to rise up against God. And so he was cast down. He did not have power in heaven. And so we find that in the Garden of Eden that he comes on the scene again, and he's a liar and he's a deceiver. He always has been, he always will be. He's good at telling lies and being deceptive to humanity. Don't buy into his lies. And so he comes and he lies to that first man and woman as they are in the garden. Once again, in the book of Genesis chapter number 3, we are given a prophecy that is given that power is even going to be taken more away from him. Jesus comes, amen, as it was prophesied, and he dies upon Calvary, and he takes the power of death and hell and the grave away from the enemy. He is weak. Don't buy into his lies. He has no authority, has no power over you as a child of God. So the things that he comes and he lies to you about, that you're unworthy, that you have deficiencies, that God can't use you, that is a lie from the pit of hell. You look at the book of Judges and you will find that God gives us an example of men and women living in a very deteriorated state round about them in the nation of Israel, where there is worship of Baal that is going on and there is lots of compromise, but God uses men and women, amen, even in their deficiencies to build the kingdom of God. We live in a country that has fallen away from the things of God. I've been born into this. Some of this isn't things that I've done in my life. It has deteriorated things around about me. But we look and we see that there are other men and certainly a woman here who was born that God raises up and uses even in the middle of their deficiencies. God wants to use you this morning even in the middle of your deficiency. But you've got to submit your deficiencies to God and live according to the holy word of God. God is still a holy God, and he still wants holy people. The secret to his strength was God. The secret to our strength is God. In the book of Colossians chapter number 3, the word of God says, set your affections on things above, not on things of this earth. We often stop there, but the word of God goes on down to say, for ye are dead, and your life is hid in Christ, in God. The key to our life is knowing that we are dead to ourselves, but we are hid in Christ, and in him we live. And that is our source of strength. Where does this power come from? That we live life with joy, and we live life with victory, and we live life with purpose, and we live life free from condemnation. Amen. Because we are hid in Christ. How many has the devil robbed your joy? Amen. How many has the devil robbed your purpose? How many has the devil interfered in your home and in the various areas of your life because he lies and he deceives? God has come to give us victory. Samson's life did not have to end this way, Brother Craig. But because of his deficiencies, getting the best of him. But even in his deficiencies, God used him. We know that in his own strength, and that's what Samson was living, Sister Tina. He wasn't living where God wanted him to live. He tampered around with too many other things in the world. And so he's trying to live on his own strength, though, Josh. And he says every time to Delilah, when she starts asking, where does your sense of your source of strength lie? He's lying around in her lap, and he gets closer and closer to telling her where it is. All the time, sister, stay safe. The problem with the church is this, as we've been lying in the lap of the world too long. Yes. And not engaging ourselves in the presence of God Almighty more than anything else. Lost in the riches of His Word and the depth of His doctrine and in the power of the Spirit. Amen. God, help us to get out of the lap of the world and into the arms of Jesus and start living in the power, amen, of His might. And so finally, he says, it's in my hair. My great strength lies in my hair. If it gets cut, I'll be as weak as any other man. And so we know that she awakes him. And in that passionate, gentle voice, she says, Samson, Samson, behold, the Philistines are upon you. And the Bible says that he got up and he shook himself. But this time he realized that the Spirit of God was gone. And he wished not that the Spirit of God had departed from him. Listen, we as the church, amen, we have got to start living in the Spirit and in the power of God, amen, to help us in our life. Not living in the strength of ourselves, amen, not tampering around with the things of this world, but loving God and living in the power of His might. His eyes are worn out with hot irons. He's bound in brass chains. His head is shaven. His strength is gone. And here he is grinding corn for the Philistines in their prison house. What a sad place to be. The greatest thing about this story, Brother Rick, is God is a God of comebacks. I love that. God is a God of comebacks, because God has a plan for our future. God has a plan. There's a few things I want to look at this morning, and that is that even in his deficiencies, God had a plan for him. The first thing I want to look at is I think sometimes in our life we don't allow fear to overtake us. I originally this morning was going to start out preaching about Gideon as I was thinking and studying this week, but then I kind of grouped some things together and began to get a bigger overall picture. One day when I preached just on Gideon. But I look at Gideon, and God had called him to be a judge just as Samson was called. But one of the things that's marked about Gideon's life is this, is that he almost didn't do something for God because of fear. You know what the Word of God says? Be anxious or be fearful for nothing. I found that in life, folks can find themselves in places where fear can overcome them, that they can do nothing for God. You know, we can start out that place in our life where we can say, well, I'm too young to do anything for God. Who will listen to me? I have no experience under my belt. I have no resume. I have no credentialing of things that's happening. So I'm too young. And sometimes folks can say, well, I'm single, and how can I do anything because I'm single? You know what it becomes? It becomes anxiousness. It becomes fear. It becomes things that become hindrances for doing anything for God. And then we may say, well, I'm married, or I'm tied down, or I have children, or I'm at a different place in life. You know what? The bottom line is this. They are fears and anxieties in our life that keep us from doing what God wants us to do. The Word of God says to be anxious for nothing. Amen. Fear and anxiety will keep us from doing something for God. You know what anxiety is? It's looking at tomorrow, it's looking at the future, and bringing in all the negatives that really have no substance at all. God, help us to be anxious for nothing, amen, but to work for the kingdom of God. Do you know that the power of God, amen, works beyond our fears? beyond any anxiety that we may have, what has been in the past, amen, what is presently our condition that seems to keep us confined, amen, God wants to break those anxieties. He wants to move in our life. I believe this as well, that God in a very dark time was reaching out to the nation of Israel. They were bound by idolatry. They were worshiping and bringing customs of other gods into their lives. You know what? It's time that we clean out the closets, clean out our homes, things that have taken precedence over the power and the plan and the purpose of God in our life. We get rid of them. Amen. Till our heart is sold out to God unconditionally. God help us not to be anxious for anything, but to trust you. God takes Gideon and he says, I'm taking you down to 300 men, and you're going to go fight the Midianites, which is over 130,000 men. We know that they were, would you like to take 300 and fight with that amount of men against a number that is multiple times what you have? Amen. God says, listen, Gideon, I want to use you. Get rid of all the anxiety and fear. And God uses him. Look, you may look at your life and you may say, what I'm up against, Pastor, is so much greater than what is in me. No, my friend, I want to tell you, God knows what is exactly in you. God knows exactly what you have. God knows your potential. God knows your past. God knows your present. God knows everything about you. He knows your weaknesses. He knows your strengths better than you do. Amen. Would you just allow God into the equation? And would you allow him to do something great in your life? Amen. Be anxious for nothing. Amen. Don't be fearful. God has you covered.
Amen.
Fear. Amen. I believe this. You know, we look at America. We look at the need for revival. We look at where we are as a culture. We can't be fearful to open our mouth about Jesus Christ and to share the gospel. You say, Pastor Bill, I feel like I'm the minority. Well, the devil wants you to feel that way. All the other religious lies of the enemy would shout out to you that you're the minority. But I want you to know that you are the majority. When Christ gets in the equation, that we are to be anxious or fearful for nothing. The kingdom of heaven rests upon us in doing the work and the will of God. I got to move on quickly this morning. I believe not only do we deal with that of fear, but I believe oftentimes we can be stagnant in our life because of rejection. How would you like to have been the prophet Jeremiah? Solely rejected, preaching a gospel, and Brother Josh, no one listened. He wept, he cried, but he kept on preaching. He said it this way. Amen. Brother Dennis sung about it. Brother David testified about it. Amen. He said, it's like a fire shut up in my bones. Listen, who cares what anyone on the outside may think or feel about the power of Christ and the message of the gospel? As long as the fire of God is shut up inside of us, that is all that matters. And what a desperate hour we live in having the fire of God shut up in us like a fire in our bones. Amen. I will preach the gospel. It doesn't matter if I'm rejected. It doesn't matter if people do not accept the word of God. Amen. It is fire shut up in my bones. God has a plan for my life. God has a plan for the future. Amen. And I'm convinced that the devil, he rejects the message of Christ. Amen. He wants everyone else to reject it. Amen. But I've been changed by this gospel, so I must share it. And then not only fear, Gideon, you had fear. And Jeremiah, you faced rejection. But we look at a man named Moses. We talked about his inadequacies. Listen, God, I can't go and I can't tell Pharaoh to let your people go. No, he was full of excuses. Did you ever look at Moses? He is full of excuses. Sometimes we mirror Moses very well. We can be full of all kinds of excuses. I have all kinds of inadequacies, God. I can't do it. I can't do it. I can't do it. I just can't. Listen, God knows what we can do. Finally says, okay, but God, I want to take my brother Aaron along with me. You ever look at Moses' life? Brother David, I don't see Aaron talking when he goes to Pharaoh. He must have just needed Aaron for some good moral support. Whatever your inadequacies, Moses, I've called you. And I want to use you. Listen, we need revival in the hour in which we live. We need to do something for the kingdom of God. Amen. In the hour in which we live. You may feel anxious. Amen. Don't be anxious for anything. Fear is just a tool of the enemy. Amen. Get rid of it. You may say, well, what if I'm rejected? Listen, I would rather be rejected by all and accepted by Christ. Amen. When I count my life as lost, amen, He counts it as a gain for eternity. And whatever my inadequacies are, I give them to Christ. Don't ever doubt this morning. The devil, he loves to bring weariness and distress and discouragement. He wants to bring doubt. They were sent out. What does the land look like? Joshua and Caleb, they came back. Did they have doubt in their heart? Oh, God can conquer these giants. Amen. We want that mountain. And because they did not allow doubt to overtake them, the mountain was theirs. I'm talking this morning to a church that we need to see revival. Amen. We need to see culture change. Amen. We need to see the kingdom of God grow. Amen. We need to see the advancement of the Holy Ghost like we've never seen before. The enemy, he'll want to put anxiousness in our heart and fear and inadequacies and doubt. Amen. But God wants to work and move in our life and give us the mountain. Amen. We look at Samson. Amen. And no matter what's happened in his past, he shimmies up to the pillars and he said, I may have made some mistakes. Amen. But God, I'm asking in this covenant, would you come back upon me and would you help me that I can do something great in my life? Amen. Would you shimmy up to the pillars this morning? Amen. Would you shimmer up to the pillars of the altar and say, God, I want to do something in my life. Yes, there are times I feel anxious and fearful, and there are times that I doubt. And yes, I know my inadequacies. And yes, God, I don't want to be rejected. But above all that, I want to be touched of you. Amen. That's what it's about this morning. Asking God to help us. Listen, in a society where violent crimes in the past 50 years has risen by over 500%, illegitimate births have increased over 400%. Divorce rates have increased over 400%. Where single parent homes have increased by 300%. Where teenage suicide has increased over 200%. We need some men who will rise up and do something for the kingdom of God. If Sister Stanley would come to the piano this morning. Listen, my message this morning as God has tugged at my heart, I believe the Spirit of God is tugging at the hearts of people
the Miracle Revival Church. And let's think this hour and maximize it for the kingdom of God. For so many men and women who are filled with the Spirit of God. I appreciate what Brother David said. I still believe in being filled with the Spirit.